Welcome back. Today's headlines of CCTV's news bulletin are Chemical in the Americas 2020's welcome reception, an interview on Latin America, and to start with, Lynn Bergesen with some sound bites from yesterday's seminar on Tosca.
Where to begin? We had just completed two seminars on Tosca. We have an embarrassment of riches from our colleagues at EPA headquarters. Senior EPA leadership is here. We learned about the forthcoming final CDR rule. We learned about refinements to the risk evaluations, systematic review process. We learned EPA is likely to be issuing a unilateral order for purposes of dislodging some of the ancient Section 5 pending PMN applications. We learned so much. If you were not here, I regret that, but those of you who were will attest to the fact that it was a fabulous multi-program, multi-session seminar this morning, and we were very, very fortunate to have excellent speakers and excellent new information.
So EPA really appreciated this opportunity to talk to the regulated industry about a lot of the major activities that have been going on in our office right now. First of all, it was a good opportunity to give an update on where we're at with implementing the Tosca fees rule and some of the issues that have been raised recently around how the agency is going about doing that work. It was also a good opportunity to learn and share and exchange around our experiences with doing risk evaluations under Tosca Section 6, and to hear from folks who have gone through that process, as well as share some of our insights of what we've learned as we begin to implement this really important part of Tosca. Also, we're able to give an update on the low priority prioritization chemicals, and indicating that we're happy that even though we were a little late in making the due date, we think that we did an excellent job of setting up a really strong case for why those 20 chemicals should not be a priority right now for the agency to look at through risk evaluation.
EPA's new chemicals review program has been making significant progress in addressing cases under review over 90 days. We have a 76% decrease in those number of cases since last year, and we're continuing on that path to finish as many as possible in this year. In addition, we are looking for ways to clear out those cases that have been too long with submitters, including the use of a unilateral order to close out those cases. In addition, we're looking at additional innovative ways to address incomplete or less than robust submissions. We'll be coming out with some ideas on that soon.
This ChemCon session has been really terrific. It's been a great learning opportunity. We've heard a lot from experienced practitioners about Tosca best practices. We've also heard some terrific updates from EPA. Great to hear that the backlog's being reduced. It's great to hear that EPA is staffing up finally. They're managing to hire more than they're losing to retirement. Those are both great positive aspects to EPA's all the work that's going on in OPPT. It's been a terrific learning opportunity and great to reconnect with people in the Tosca space.
Let's connect with Benjamin Franklin and learn more about yesterday's welcome reception. Mr. Franklin, where are you?
I just wanted to come down and take a quick look at the Benjamin Franklin Bridge. And, you know, looking at the Delaware reminds me of the joy of swimming. When I was a boy, I used two wooden paddles, very much like painter's palettes. I would insert them in the water on their sides and then push back on the water as I drew my arms back. They helped me swim a lot faster, but greatly fatigued my wrists.
Your ID created swim fins, still widely used today. And you also discovered the power of wind, that you could fly a kite and that pulls you effortlessly across a pond. Nowadays we have kite surfing that goes up to 60 miles per hour, double the speed of a fast horse and carriage. And on ice, even faster than speed skaters.
Ah, skating in winter. I remember people skating on the Delaware. But apparently due to climate change, that doesn't happen anymore. You have to use artificial ice, such as your delegates saw at the Riverwink Winterfest at their great reception last night.
The welcome reception was on Philadelphia's waterfront at Blue Cross Riverwink Winterfest, where our delegates had a great opportunity to network in a magical winter wonderland. In this cozy ambience, they were treated to a nice figure skating performance and had the opportunity to warm themselves at fire pits and experience a Dutch stroopwafelsmoor. Today's interview will take us to a warmer region, Latin America. We learned about the current developments and goals for chemicals legislation in that region. Alejandra, in 2018, Brazil was the front runner in Latin America. Are they still leading the dance?
I can say that during 2018 and 2019, maybe it was particularly Argentina who took the front row in leading chemical regulation, and several other countries, particularly those that were planning to enter OECD, started doing their business as well. But I can say that I expect Brazil to come back again. They got the support from USA to enter OECD.
Okay, and what kind of initiative do you see then?
Well, definitely we're talking mainly about risk management activities, inventories, DHS. They have, as we all in the region, we still have a lot of things to implement when it comes to DHS.
Roland, the Latin American Regulatory Cooperation Forum, they encourage local authorities to establish regulatory cooperation between the different countries. Would you also define the current developments, as Alejandra described, as a success?
From where we started with individual countries doing individual legislations, I think we have seen more collaboration. Clearly, from an industry standpoint, we would want this to increase further. And I think the forum from industry side is trying to encourage risk-based legislations, cooperation between the governments, to have frameworks in place that serve the objective.
You can watch the complete interview on our YouTube channel. Let's return to Benjamin Franklin. Mr. Franklin, where are you?
I'm looking over the development of Philadelphia from One Liberty Place. I am also next to the tallest statue of me, which rises 900 feet from his feet up to his head. What a marvelous view of the city.
Your hard work and innovation laid the foundation for Philadelphia as it is today, always believing in the greater good. As a visionary, you understood the value of environmental measures. Could you share some ideas in relation to the environment that you had?
Why, yes. Let us go back to 1739, when my neighbors and I petitioned the Pennsylvania Assembly to remove waste and sewage from the commercial district of Philadelphia. Waste disposal remained a big problem in the city, which we tried to take care of. Fortunately, with a large city and a growing population, there was growing interest in solving this problem. As I once said, when the well is dry, we know the worth of water. In my will, I left a sum of money to build a freshwater pipeline to supply the city of Philadelphia. Has that ever been done?
Yes, in 1797, your initiative resulted in the formation of the Philadelphia Water Commission. In 1799, the first freshwater pipeline and waterworks were constructed at Center Square. That's the site of currently the City Hall. Philadelphia's second waterworks at Fairmont Waterworks provided for more than two centuries the municipal water system. Also in our time, many initiatives to make improvements to human health and the environment, like the Chemical Universe, an initiative from ECHA. Let's discuss this with Ophelia Beckeru from ECHA. Ophelia, welcome.
Thank you.
Ophelia, can you explain why ECHA is mapping the chemical universe?
Mapping the chemical universe is part of the agency's commitment to address all registered chemicals by 2027. So basically, by 2027, the agency wants to decide which chemicals need to be regulated and which are considered of low priority or low concern. Mapping the chemical universe, it's a tool which helps to prioritize the work and to address each substance with the right regulatory measure. For example, a substance would rather go to harmonized classification than to substance evaluation. And the mapping would help to understand which of two actions is better.
And your statement is?
The mapping of substances in the chemical universe is a transparent way to monitor the progress made in regulating chemicals.
Ophelia, thank you very much for your outlook for the future of the chemical universe. Now it's time for the forecast, so let's see what we have in store today. We start with exciting presentations from authority representatives from Argentina, Brazil, Colombia, and Mexico. Before we learn from industry on the aims and achievements of the Latin America Regulatory Cooperation Forum and the implementation of GHS in the Americas, followed by an insight in the US-Mexico-Canada agreement and its implications for the chemical industry. In the afternoon, we look at the safe use of chemicals in the chemical universe, with, among others, EPA on new approach methodologies for data generation, the latest trends on roads around the globe, and supply chain transparency. At the end of the day, more on chemical control legislation in Canada and the USA, with, among others, state initiatives on ingredients communication and safe products, initiatives that deserve follow-up. But will this happen? As Benjamin Franklin says,
wise men don't need advice. Fools don't take it.
What are we? Enjoy your day.